Welcome back to Roar Tech Channel. 6 months ago, I bought the Prusa MK3S Plus. I was really impressed by its overall performance, high quality brand name parts, as well as every small detail they put into the design and how convenient it is as a 3D printer. The only downside is the price. It's more expensive than all the other budget 3D printers that I have. The printer itself is $750 and the shipping to the US costs $50, so I had to pay $800 for this printer. However, I did make another video to compare with the $155 Ender 3 and I still think that it's worth it. I also got interested in their Prusa Mini Plus, which is a more budget-friendly 3D printer that has a price of $349. If you want a filament sensor, you need to add $20, and shipping would be another $50. The total price I paid for this printer was $419 to be delivered to California. It's about half the price of the Prusa MK3S Plus. I expect this Prusa Mini Plus to be the same quality and be just as convenient to use, but with a smaller print volume. Today, I will assemble it, do some test prints, and talk about what I think about this printer. Let's open the box and see what's inside. All the parts are put inside different boxes. Since I ordered the kit version instead of the pre-assembled version, there are quite a lot of parts inside, and I need to put them together myself, just like for the Prusa MK3S Plus. I regret that I didn't pay an extra $50 to get the pre-assembled version, as now I have to put every bolt and nut together by myself. I don't have any problems assembling it, but I would highly recommend that you pay $50 to order the pre-assembled version. For the Prusa MK3S Plus, the price difference between the DIY kit and the pre-assembled printer is $350, which means you can save $350 if you are willing to spend 5 hours to put it together by yourself. But for this Prusa Mini Plus, the reward is just $50, and the time it took to assemble is almost the same as the MK3S Plus. It took me 4.5 hours. As you can see, the Mini itself is definitely smaller, but when you add up the space required for the spool holder and the power supply, it actually can't save much space unless you mount the filament spool on the printer or hang it up on the rack. Let's turn on the printer first. The color screen is really nice. It is kind of small, but it's good enough to show all the information you need to see. However, it's not a touchscreen, and we still need to use the knob to select the item. A setup wizard shows up, and I will follow it to test and calibrate the printer. Then, it shows some simple instructions on how to read the numbers on the screen. First, it will start with a fan test, including the hot end fan and the print fan. I think this kind of self-test is quite nice, as the user can make sure that they've connected all the cables correctly and all the parts work before the first print. Next, it will test all the axes, X, Y, and Z. After that, it will heat up the nozzle and the heat bed. The nozzle can actually heat up to 290 degrees, so this printer should be able to print with most filaments, including nylon filament, which requires 270 to 290 degrees. Okay. It now shows all tests finished successfully. We will follow the instructions on the screen and load some filament. Then, it will calibrate the Z offset. It depends on how you install the bed leveling sensor, but generally, it should be 1-2 millimeters higher than the nozzle. We will use this calibration feature to find out. First, it will do auto bed leveling and it actually probes 16 points on this tiny bed. The Super Pinda sensor works very well, and it took around 30 seconds to finish. After the printing temperature is reached, it starts printing. As expected, it should print in the air in the beginning, as our bed leveling sensor is higher than the nozzle. I will adjust it down until the first layer prints perfectly. Okay, I think -1 millimeters is fine. Let it finish the print and see how it looks. The lines are good, and the rectangle at the corner is also good. I will stick to this and try some more prints. Let's see what sample G-code files were preloaded on the USB drive that came with this printer. I will try the 3D Benchy. We can see the preview of the print, which is nice. Press print again to confirm, and it will heat up to 170 degrees to do auto bed leveling. After the bed leveling is done, it will heat up to 215, which is the preset printing temperature for PLA, as I'm using the sample black Galaxy PLA that came with this printer. The first layer sticks pretty nicely, as we calibrated the nozzle offset to 1 mm. The motion system of this Prusa Mini is the same as the MK3S Plus. They are both using linear rods instead of rubber pulley wheels, and the movement is quite smooth. You can also adjust the print settings on the screen in real time, including the most important one, Live Adjust Z, which can adjust the height of the nozzle during print to get the perfect first layer. The overhanging part of the benchy looks good. There's just some tiny stringing, but it's normal, as this Galaxy Black PLA strings a little more than my other PLA filament. Okay, the print is now finished. Let's compare it to the one printed by the Prusa MK3S Plus. As you can see, these two benchies are identical. Let's also compare it to another one printed by the Two Trees Bluer Plus. They are the same price, but the Bluer Plus is a larger scale 300x300x400mm printer. I made another video to review this printer, and I put the link under the description if you're interested. Next, we will go to the Prusa website to find a filament holder. I saw that many users printed a spool holder that is mounted on the side of the printer right behind the screen, which saves a lot of space. This design looks perfect. It's a two-piece design, and the spool holder has a flat part at the bottom to support the weight of the filament spool. Let's print the first part. I will use Prusa Slicer's default settings. I will select a 0.25mm layer height to save some time, as we don't really need high details for this functional part. And a 20% infill should be good. It prints quite nicely at first, but when the height reaches above 50mm, there are some layer bending issues, and some layers are compressed for some reason. It gets worse when it reaches around 100mm. The Z-axis can't move up anymore, and it keeps printing at the same height. I have to stop the print to try to find the cause. The print actually stopped at 106mm. I will run the self-test again, and it seems the X, Y, and Z axes are all normal. But when you watch the Z axis closely, the lead screw is slightly bent. Let me replay this a few times, and if you focus here, you can see it. However, it seems the self-test did not find this issue. I will try to manually move the Z axis and see if there is any resistance when it reaches a certain height. When I try to move it up at around 100mm, you can hear that it sounds like something is blocking its way, and I can visually tell that the lead screw is not perfectly straight. In this case, I will loosen the trapezoidal lead screw nut a little bit. When I try to move the Z-axis up and down around the 100mm zone again, the weird sound was gone. I think it should be fine now, so I will print the same model again. As you can see, this time there are no more layer bending issues. All the layers look nice from bottom to top. The spool holder is quite large, and we still need to print the second part. I will use the same default settings and print at 0.25 layer height and 20% infill. It took another 2.5 hours to finish the second part. I will put them together like this, and this spool holder really makes a difference. The Mini can now fit on the rack nicely. Let's talk about the differences between the Prusa MK3S Plus and the Mini Plus. First, the print volume of the MK3S Plus is 210x210x250, while the Mini's print volume is 180x180x180. As you can see, the Mini build plate is much smaller than the MK3S Plus. But in fact, I would say this build plate can fit 90% of my normal prints, so 180x180 is not that small. Second, as the Mini Plus is almost half the price of the MK3S Plus, many brand name parts in the MK3S Plus were replaced by some unbranded or Prusa in-house developed parts, like the Mizumi bearings, which were replaced by some unbranded ones. You need to lubricate them one by one before use, but I can't see any significant negative effects on the print quality yet. Third, the power supply. It's still a Delta power supply, but as the print bed is smaller, it's just 150 watts. Fourth, the print head. Since the Mini Plus has only one Z axis, the whole X axis weight and the print head will be supported by one side. So, Prusa made it a Bowden tube setup to reduce weight. Instead of the Bontech gears and E3D V6 hot end, you will get a Prusa in-house hot end assembly. This Bowden setup should print a little slower than the MK3S Plus direct drive setup, but I also can't see any significant negative effects on the print quality yet. Finally, you will get a full roll of filament for the MK3S Plus, but you only get a few meters of sample filament for this Mini Plus. Next, I will talk about what new features that came with the Mini Plus that you won't see on the MK3S Plus. First, a color screen. It's not a touch screen, so you still need to turn the knob to select and navigate the menu. Second, it supports a full-size USB drive instead of an SD or micro SD card. It's more convenient when you need to copy files from your computer. Third, it finally came with a 32-bit board. The STM32F407 is a fast chip, which is more than 2 times faster than the basic 32-bit chip on an Ender 3. There is no difference in this print quality, but a faster processor can make the printer expandable with more features. Fourth, this motherboard also supports the ESP01 module, which means you can add an ESP8266 Wi-Fi module and print over Wi-Fi, but this feature is not supported by the current firmware yet. If the firmware supports this feature in the future, you can print directly from your computer slicer like the Kaiwoo Tycoon printer. If you are interested in that printer, you can watch my other video. Finally, the printer also came with an RJ45 connector, which means you can plug your Ethernet cable and use this printer over the network. I expected that I could print over the network, but I am quite disappointed with this feature. The firmware only supports monitoring the printer over the network, which just shows a browser-based interface with some information you can get on the printer screen, like the temperature and current print remaining time. In conclusion, I think the print quality of this Prusa Mini Plus is awesome. It prints just as well as the Prusa MK3S Plus. If you are a beginner, I would recommend this printer as your first or second printer, but I don't recommend the kit version. For a person who has some 3D printer experience, you may need 4 to 5 hours to put this together, but for a beginner, it may take 8 hours or longer, and you also have to take the risk of putting the parts together incorrectly. So, it's worth it to pay another $50 to get the almost pre-assembled version. This printer is easy to use and works well with the Prusa slicer. It would definitely give you a better 3D printing experience compared to other low-range 3D printers like the Ender 3 and its variants. Many brand-name parts are gone compared to the MK3S Plus, but there are no significant negative effects on the print quality. The only part I am disappointed with is the network feature. The Ethernet connector and the Wi-Fi module expansion slot have been there since the Prusa Mini original version, which was launched almost 2 years ago. I don't understand why the firmware still does not support network printing. While this basic feature has been supported by other budget printers like Kaiwoo, Two Trees, and many printers using the Robin Nano motherboard. Besides that, I am quite happy with this Prusa Mini Plus. At the end of the day, you pay half the price of its big brother, the Prusa MK3S Plus, and get the same print quality, enjoy the same easy-to-use design, and it's also a reliable 3D printer. I've also added a Raspberry Pi to enable Wi-Fi printing using Octopi. The printer is working great. If you are considering this printer, the money you need to spend would be $349 for the Prusa Mini Plus, $20 for the filament sensor, $50 for the pre-assembled version instead of the DIY kit, $50 for shipping, and if you also want to enable Wi-Fi printing, then another $80 for the Raspberry Pi. The total would be $549 to get the exact same setup as this. If you prefer to wait for the firmware update to support the Ethernet connector that came with this printer, the total would be $469. That's it for this video. If you liked this video, please hit the like and subscribe button. My brother and I make a new video every weekend, so check out my channel on Mondays and you'll see something new. See you next week.